Hare Krishna. So today I'll speak on the theme of how the Bhagavad Gita is an expression of Krishna's love. The same Lord who plays the flute to call the gopis. That is what comes, the sound that comes from him is the Venu Gita. And that same Lord with the same lips, he speaks the Bhagavad Gita. So I'll talk this class in two parts. We'll take two similar verses from the Bhagavad Gita, and by focusing on their dissimilarities, we'll try to see how Krishna's love is seen. So there are two verses in the Bhagavad Gita which are almost identical. They are 934 and 1865. So 934 is Manmana Bhava Mad Bhakto Madhyaji Mam Namaskuru Mame Vaishyasis Yuktvaivam Atmanam Matparayanam. So Mame Vaishyasi. Till this point, this verse and the next verse, 1865, is similar. Manmana Bhava Mad Bhakto Madhyaji Mam Namaskuru Mame Vaishya Satyam Te Pratijane Priyosime. So Mame Vaishya, till that point is similar. Satyam Te Pratijane Priyosime. The first verse is Krishna is calling upon us, Manmana Bhava, fix your mind on me, become devoted to me, worship me, offer your obeisances to me, and in this way you will come to me. That part is similar. But in 934, what Krishna is saying? Yuktvaivam atmanam matparayanaha. If you are engaged in this way, you will come to me. In 1865, he is saying, Mam evaishyasi satyam te pratijane priyosime. This is the truth I declare. And I speak the truth because you are dear to me. And not only are you dear to me, pratijane. I declare, I proclaim that you are dear to me. So, the difference is, in the first verse, Krishna is emphasizing what we need to do. He says, if you do this, you will come to me. Then the second verse, he's saying, if you do this, you just do this and I guarantee I'll do my part and I'll get you to me. You'll come to me. So, suppose somebody wants to maybe sell a house or something like that. And initially they are very cautious about the buyer. Will this buyer actually give the money or not? So if you pay this money this time, you pay this money this time, you pay this money this time, then the property will be yours. So this is where the buyer is cautious, where the seller is cautious. But if the seller is desperate to sell the property, seller says, if you just do this, I guarantee you the property will be yours. So in a sense, Krishna actually is becoming very intense, eager that Arjuna listen to him. And Arjuna basically abide by his will. So sometimes the same statement can be there, but depending on what is the stress in the statement, the meaning can change completely. Say for example, if somebody is being considered for some responsibility, and say one person wants to support that person, their candidature. You may say, he had problems earlier, but now he's stable. But somebody who wants to oppose that their candidature, they may take the same facts and say, he's stable now, but he had problems earlier. Same point, but completely opposite meaning. So what happens? Opposite implication. So the stress very much matters. So if we see the Bhagavad Gita not just as a book of philosophy, but as a personal reciprocation between Krishna and Arjuna, then we see a lot of sublime layers of meaning and taste in the Bhagavad Gita. So essentially, what is the import of these two verses? All of us, when we live in the world, we understand that we have to navigate and negotiate. Whatever it is that we want to achieve, we have to navigate our way. The world is like an ocean. Just for driving, we have to navigate the traffic and go to a particular place. Yes, so similarly, in our relationship, we have to navigate with different people. In the corporate world, we have to navigate our way through. So the world is like a stormy sea through which we have to navigate. And while navigating, we have to negotiate. Okay, you know, I want to go in this direction, but the wind is, these waves are too strong over here. So then I will go in this direction first, and then I'll go in that direction. That happens when, say, we are driving. So if the road this way, we have to go this way, but the road is blocked. I'll go this way first, and then I'll go that way. So basically, for navigating, we have to negotiate. Negotiate means give and take. So this is navigating and negotiating. These are the two essential challenges of our life journey. Whatever it is that we have to do in life, okay, where do I want to go? That's navigation. Negotiation is, how will I get there? In fact, these two words are in Sanskrit, can be broadly related to sadhya and sadhana. Sadhya is, what is it that I want to achieve? Where do I want to navigate to get to? And sadhana is the means. Okay, how I want to get there? So navigate and negotiate. Now all of us have to do this at different times in life. It may be in different contexts. But ultimately, we are not just navigating and negotiating in life. We are actually navigating and negotiating with life. Why with life? Because life is like a race. And it's a race in which everyone is running. But this is a peculiar race that whoever gets to the finish line, they are shot down, dead. Now, whether you come first or last, when you come to the finishing line, you are shot. There's an Italian proverb which says that at the end of the chess match, the king and the pawn both go into the same box. So similarly, the life is a race where there is, at one level, it seems there is ultimate futility. That we are going to lose everything. Then what are we racing for? We say, no, before that I want to enjoy life. Okay, that's fine. But is that all that we want? Is there something beyond? So when we live in the world, broadly speaking, we could say that some people think this world is all that matters. And some people say, what is there after death? There is nothing. Why? Because if we ask those who have died, what is there after death? They reply, nothing. They don't reply. They don't reply at all. So some people may say, this world is all that exists. And there's nothing beyond this world. So we could have like a four quadrant diagram. Some people say this world is all, there is this world and there is something beyond this world. So some people say this world is all that matters. And so if you have this quadrant, this world matters, the other world doesn't matter at all. Or one quadrant could be, neither this world matters nor the other world matters. Life is itself meaningless. A third quadrant could be, this world doesn't matter, only the other world matters. And the fourth quadrant is, this world matters and the other world matters. So among these four ways, those who think neither this world matters nor the other world matters, they are people who live a life of apathy, of apathy, lack of energy, lethargy, depression. Now, when depression comes upon people, people become so apathetic, they just can't do anything. Some people are such that if they get an award for laziness, they will ask, can you courier it to me? So, nothing matters in their lives. It's a very dark and dreary place to be in. If you feel nothing matters, then what is the point of living at all? life is tough. And to go through the struggles of life, we need to have that conviction that something matters, that it's worthwhile going through all this. So more and more people are going into this first quadrant. Neither this life matters, nor anything beyond matters. And because this is unbearable, nobody can stay here for very long. You have to get out of here. So how do you get out? One way is by thinking that, okay, this world is all that matters. Like, okay, maybe after that there is nothing, but till then I want to live and I want to have a good life and I want to enjoy. And most of modern technological progress is based on this assumption. So if we consider from the dawn of the age of science, from the 16th, 17th centuries onwards, the whole effort has been on trying to improve this world. And in many ways, we have succeeded. We have, ordinary people today have comforts that were unimaginable even for royalty a few centuries ago. Air conditioning, air transport, telecommunications. So we have significantly improved the world. But the problem is that we all need enduring meaning. And it is ironical that today, if you talk with people about some spiritual world, some life beyond this life, their most probable response will be, this is mythology. No, this is a pre-scientific myth. We don't believe in this. This is nonsense. But while they very strongly reject that, just living as if this world is all that matters is not very palatable. There's a survey done of how people live. What are the mental states of people, especially in the Western world, where people who are prosperous, healthy, young? Around 5% of the time, people are happy. 5% of the time, people are unhappy. 90% of the time, they are bored. They're bored. Because this world itself is not always stimulating. What is there? We may eat and enjoy, but we can't eat all the time. We may want sensual pleasures, we can't do that all the time. We want to look at beautiful things, but not many things are beautiful. I was at a college program, so one boy had come for the college, and he said, there's like a slogan written on his t-shirt. The slogan said, 90% of the world's women are beautiful, the remaining 10% are in my college. So, what happens basically is, the sensory fair of the world is never up to what we desire. And because we can't live in this quadrant very satisfactorily, it's not stimulating, it's not sufficiently satisfying. So the same people who very vigorously reject the idea of any religious other world, they create a fictional other world. A fictional world through comics, through movies, through dramas. And they get obsessed with that. They get completely obsessed with that. That if you see, entertainment has always been a part of human society. But the obsession with entertainment that we have today, that has not been there in the past. Obsession is not just in terms of the millions and millions of dollars that are spent on entertainment. In fact, if we consider in India, there is the IPL, the Indian Premier Cricket League. Probably here, basketball or baseball or American soccer we will have. So the amount of money that is spent in India in 50 days on the IPL, that is enough to feed all the hungry people of India throughout the year. Now it's a phenomenal amount of money that is spent. Now where is it coming from? It is coming from people. And why are people spending so much money? Because the entertainment is serving a desperately felt need. And what is that desperately felt need? That is, we all need a satisfying object of thought. We are not just physical creatures who need food. We are not just food, clothing, shelter. We are not just biological machines who are designed to survive and reproduce and avoid pain. We want something more. And what we want is a satisfying object of thought. Something satisfying to think about. And that, if we believe this world is all that matters, then this world is not a satisfying object of thought most of the time. And that's why you will see the same people who are, you could say, almost fanatically materialistic. We often talk about fanatical religionists, but you can have fanatical materialists also. Fanatical materialists are those who say matter is all that matters. At least those who say matter is all that matters, they are functional materialists. Fanatical materialists are those who say matter is all that exists. Nothing. They are, we could say, pure devotees of matter. So now, those same people who say there is no world beyond this world, they get so obsessed with fiction. Maybe a few decades ago, fiction, you know, Harry Potter and stuff like that, was what small kids watched. But now we see adults are obsessed with it. No, video games and so much stuff like that. So why is that? If we just live as if this world is all that matters, it's not satisfying. And then the same people take the other world also very seriously. But that other world is a fictional world. Now people sometimes have arguments over this fictional character is better, that fictional character is better. And there can be fights over it. So sports is not unreal. Sports is, people perform in the sports. But actually, in one sense, sports is meant for entertainment. But sometimes if one team starts losing, riots break out. So what is happening? Something which is created for entertainment, people are ending up taking out so seriously, more seriously than anything else. I was in Australia and I was giving this talk. And after that, a Sri Lankan came and met me. And so when about 5-6 years ago, Sri Lanka lost repeatedly several cricket World Cup, T20 or whatever, 3-4 finals they lost repeatedly in the finals. And then after that, almost a dozen people in Sri Lanka committed suicide. None of the players committed suicide. The fans committed suicide. And after that, one person in Australia, he came in, but he said that one of his very close friends committed suicide. And he said, both of us were mad for cricket, but when that happened, I said, I was jolted by it. How could he commit suicide? In one sense, I could understand it, but other sense, I could understand it. We were passionate about cricket. That's when he said, I started looking for some higher meaning. Why are we taking this so seriously? So, we all want something satisfying, something which will, a satisfying object of thought, something satisfying, stimulating, meaningful. So when people live as if this world is all that matters, they don't live like that. They take a fictional world seriously. Now somebody might say that, no, I understand it's fiction, I don't take it as real. Well, you may say it is fictional, but functionally, people take it as more real than real, isn't it? I saw a cartoon, it said that a man is saying that yesterday night my broadband went down. My broadband Wi-Fi went down, so I spent some time with my family. They seem like nice people. So, people end up being more connected with some person, either in a fictional character on a video game or some person on social media. And that person might have a profile which has nothing to do with their real life also. People often fake profiles. So what happens? We are not living as if this world is all that matters. We are creating some other world and living as if that matters. Now this can happen in the spiritual circle also, that sometimes some people just reject this world as illusion and they say the other world is all that matters. And that is escapism. Now, escapism can actually take both ways. Escapism, this world doesn't matter at all. That means I don't care for anything in this world. That, if we look at the history of India, this is a complex subject with political overtones, but in Indian history, when the Islamic invasion started happening, so at that time, prominently, there was the theology, the philosophy, which was that this world is Maya. This world doesn't matter at all. And that, in some ways, fueled the apathy. No, whatever happens in this world, oh, our kingdoms are destroyed. Ultimately, this is all is illusion. Don't bother about it. And now, conversely, the Islamic invasion also has this idea that this world doesn't matter. What does it mean, doesn't matter? That what you do in this world doesn't matter at all. If you are living and dying for the sake of Allah, then you are going to be redeemed. And so, what happens to us doesn't matter. That is one kind of apathy. The other is, what we do doesn't matter. As long as we are following our ideology, what we do doesn't matter. And this is not to single out any particular religion. This is what happened in communism also. Now, communism, which was there, now most of us know about the First World War, Second World War, and millions of people were killed in that. About 15 to 20 million people died. But few people know that actually during the reign of communism in Britain, in Russia, USSR, and China, 100 million people were killed. Several times more people were killed there by the governments themselves. So what happened was, they had this idea that we want to create a utopia in the world. So they said that we will create a world where everyone is equal. And what they did was, they took the wealth from the wealthy and started planning to distribute it to the poor. But in the process, how do you decide who is wealthy? How do you decide who is poor? So anybody who had any grudges against anyone else says, you are the victimizer, I am the victim. And eventually it ended up, so many people were killed. So their idea was, we will create a utopia where everybody is equal. But it just doesn't work like that. There's actually in USSR, this study was done. They decided in a classroom that all the students give the exam, and some students will get top grade, some students will fail. They say, at the end of the exam, all of you perform, and after that, we will, whatever grades you get, we will do the average of all the grades, and all students will get that grade. And the result of that was, that the lazy students thought that, you know, we will pass even if we don't study. And the talented students thought, you know, if we are going to get the same grade as everyone else, why should we study? And eventually, the whole class started failing. So basically, the point I'm making over here is that there are any ideology, people can get so obsessed with it that they stop caring what we are doing, because we want to create some other world. We want to create a world of absolute equality, and for that, we can do even monstrosity over here. That becomes justified. So the healthy way to live is what Krishna teaches in the Bhagavad Gita, that this world matters and the other world matters. Krishna, Arjuna wants to renounce the world and give up his duty. Krishna says, nothing doing. In fact, Arjuna thinks that, I will just stop being involved in the world. Arjuna says, I don't want to do anything. Nothing doing. So Krishna says, nothing doing to nothing doing. Nothing doing to doing nothing. If you say, I will not do anything, it's not possible. He says, act responsibly. Mam anusmara yudhyacha. Says, do your duty in this world and also remember the Lord who is beyond this world. So the way we function in the world is that we take this world seriously and we take the other world seriously also. Why the other world seriously? Because that is where we will go beyond this world. And we at our core are eternal beings and we can attain eternal life. So that is something which has to be taken seriously. In fact, this capacity to take the future seriously is what differentiates humans from animals. Animals just live according to biological instincts. They're driven to eat, they will eat. They're driven to go from here to there, they will go there. Even when animals seem to prepare for the future, they are not consciously preparing for the future. They're just biologically driven to prepare for the future. But human beings can prepare for the future. So, we take the other world seriously, but the Bhakti tradition says, take this world also seriously. That means, do your activities responsibly in this world. But while doing your activities responsibly in this world, don't let your vision be caught with this world alone. Look beyond this world and look at the Lord. So, yattaha pravrittir bhutanam yena swarvam idam tatam swakarmanatam abhyarcha siddhim vindati manava. This is 1846, 47, 48, this beautiful series of verses where Krishna says that Lord from whom everything has come, yattaha pravrittir bhutanam yena sarvam idam tatam, by whom everything is pervaded. So the connection of the world with the Lord is described, that the world comes from Him and the world is permeated by Him. And swakarmana tam abhyarcha, by your work worship Him. And if you do this, siddhim vindati manava, you will attain perfection. Now the precise verse in the Bhagavad Gita is, by your work worship Him. Swakarmana tam abhyarcha. Some people translate it as work is worship. Now work is worship is fine as a ethical or social principle. That whatever work anyone is doing, all work should have dignity of labor. All workers should be respected. Nobody should discriminate against. But work is worship is not a philosophical principle. Why? Because if work were worship, then the donkey would be the greatest worshipper. The donkey was harder than everyone else. So it's not work is worship, it's just work needs to be done in a mood of worship. Work intrinsically is not worship. Krishna is saying, swakarmanatam abhyarcha. That means, so what is the idea over here? I am talking about this, take this world seriously, take the other world seriously. So if you say work is worship, then all that you are saying is do this, do your work, don't bother about the other world. But work as a form of worship. What that means, do your work, that is take this world seriously. But worship means there is a purpose beyond this world. Take that also seriously. So work as a form of worship. What that means is that we understand that we all have different talents, different abilities, different resources in life. And all of these are gifts of God to us. Actually, whatever abilities we have, we often take it for granted. Now most of us, we have certain intelligence, certain skills, and we use them. But you know, we didn't do any programming in our mother's womb so that we had those abilities. We just had those. We worked to develop those abilities, but certain talents are deeply given. So the Bhagavad Gita's vision is that what we are is God's gift to us. What we become is our gift to God. So what we have certain abilities, certain resources, those which are given to us is God's gift to us. And what we do with it, not just what we do with it externally, but how we use them to change ourselves, what we become is our gift to God. So the idea is that there are two aspects for us to function in the world. We take this world seriously in a mood of service, in a mood of contribution. And then we take the other world seriously in a mood of devotion, of connection. So, contribution in this world, connection with the Lord, who is the source of everything, who is the master of the other world. And Maam Anusmara Yudhyacha. Yudhyacha is contribution in this world. Maam Anusmara is connection with the Lord and beyond the world. And with this, so what Krishna is telling Arjuna is that work, take whatever you are doing seriously, but don't let it alone consume your mind. Now with this background, let's come back to the 934 and 1865. Krishna says, Manmana Bhavmad Bhakto Madhyaji Mam Namaskur. So this is Krishna is telling In this way, you connect with me. What is the context of the Bhagavad Gita? Arjuna is considering. Now, should I be doing my very difficult and demanding duty of fighting a war? Krishna says, what you are doing is not as important as in what consciousness you are doing it. So he's telling, if internally you are devoted to me, then I guarantee you, you will come to me. So, what does he say over there? That manmanabhav mad bhakto madhyaji mamna. Now, these are very direct devotional activities. He says, fix your mind on me, worship me, offer your homage to me, become devoted to me. So, Krishna is not giving a vague idea, oh, just work is worship. Some people say that God is present everywhere, why do you need to go to the temple? That's like saying, the water vapor is present everywhere. Why do you need to go to a tap to get water? Just hang out your tongue. Well, you can't get water like that. Water vapor, water may be there everywhere as water vapor, but is it accessible for us? We need the water in a way that is accessible for us, and that is a tap. So similarly, yes, God is present everywhere, but we can't perceive Him everywhere. We need to go to places where we can perceive His presence. And sacred places of worship like the temple, or even in our home, a corner which we have made into a temple, there are places where we can perceive Him. We can bathe in His divine presence. And that's how we establish the connection. So Krishna says, if you give due time to connect with me by doing these activities of bhakti, then in your profession, you may be doing anything. This is 1865, few verses later, 9 earlier. Now 1856, Arjuna has been told by Krishna that sarva karmanya pisada kurvano madhyapashraya mat prasada davapnoti shashvatam padamavyam. Sarva karmanya pisada, whatever work you are doing, that is not important. What consciousness you are doing in, that is important. So if you take shelter of me, Krishna is saying that you will come to me. Mam evaishasi satyamte. Satyamte means I speak this truth. Why am I speaking the truth? Pratijane priyosimi. Pratijane means I declare this. So for Krishna is making a proclamation over here. Proclamation means he is putting his, you could say, his credibility at stake. He's saying that if you devote yourselves to me, and it's not just a matter of internal devotion, we have to have time to connect with Krishna, and then when we connect, then whatever else we do, we'll find that Krishna, that we will do it in a mood of devotion. And this is Krishna's assurance to us. Krishna is not a God who demands that you just give up the world and come to me. He doesn't demand, faith. What he demands, what he asks for actually is a reasoned decision. This is 1865, 2 verses before that Krishna says, now I have given my message to you. Vimrishaita dasheshena yathechasitha guru. Now, deliberate on this deeply and then do as you desire. So here we have a vision of a God who respects human intelligence and respects human independence. Just do as you desire. I'm not going to dominate you. Do as you desire. But don't do it just simply as you desire. Deliberate. And the Bhagavad Gita is an appeal to Krishna, to human intelligence. One of my friends recently told me that I'm planning to write a book. And he said, I'm calling it the 10 commandments of the Bhagavad Gita. So then I told him that, please don't write a book like this. He said, why? He said, the Bhagavad Gita's mood is not a mood of commandments. The Bhagavad Gita's mood is of choices and consequences. You do this, this will happen. You do this, this will happen. Now, you decide what you want to do. So, the Bhagavad Gita's mood is more invitational. It's invite yourself to inviting, to deliberate, and then to decide what to do. So, here, Krishna is promising us that if we, he's speaking to Arjuna, but through Arjuna, he's speaking to all of us, that if we become devoted to Him, then He guarantees we will come to Him. So that is how we can mold our life. The world is incredibly tough, and it can become more and more complicated. But if we just maintain an attitude of service, Krishna, whatever situation comes in my life, I want to serve you. If we maintain that attitude, no matter how much confusion comes, that service attitude will help us see a path ahead. Okay, how can I serve? I can do this now. I can do this now. I can do this. Small things we keep doing in a mood of service and we'll move forwards. Sometimes in our life, you know, we may have a particular plan for our life. It's like we are on a road and there are street lights ahead. And suddenly all the street lights go off. It's like we may have a plan for life and everything just collapses. So now, naturally, we might moan, we might curse, we might yell. But after that, we would just turn on our flashlight. And a flashlight can just show one step ahead. It cannot show the full part, but one step ahead. And if you take that one step ahead, the flashlight will show the next step ahead. And then, the next step ahead. So similarly, we may all have plans for our life, but in one moment, all plans can be disrupted. But if we have a service attitude, that service attitude is like a flashlight. Krishna, how can I serve you? That's in this situation, oh God, how can I serve you? How can I contribute? If we have that attitude, even in the darkest of situations, that can become a light for us. Okay, I can do this right now. I can do this right now. I can do this right now. And I'll conclude with a simple exercise, a thought exercise here. If you feel, I can't do anything. I'm in such a terrible situation, I just can't do anything. Then we can ask ourselves, can I make things worse? What? Things are terrible. Who wants to make them worse? No, nobody wants to make them worse. But can we make things worse? No matter how bad things are, we never lose the power to make them worse. And if we can make them worse, we can make them better also. The service attitude is that, okay, there are 100 things wrong in my life. I don't obsess over the 100 things that are wrong. I focus on how can I serve Krishna right now. If we keep that service attitude, we may, okay, this one thing I can do right. And if we do one thing right, we are not just doing that one thing right, we are actually reposing faith in Krishna. Krishna, I am your servant. And the 99 things that are wrong, which we have no idea how to set them right, Krishna can in his own way set them right. But if we look at the 100 things that are wrong and then don't look at Krishna, all that will happen is we'll become so discouraged, we'll not even set that one thing right. Rather, we are 100 things are wrong and we'll make 101st thing wrong. So we look at the world and we look at Krishna beyond the world. And when we have this attitude, no matter how difficulties come, we'll be able to navigate them. If we take only this world seriously, then our problems may overwhelm us. If we take only the other world seriously, again, we will not do anything to deal with the problems and the problems will overwhelm us. But if we take this world seriously and take the other world seriously, then what will happen? We'll focus our vision on Krishna and then deal with this world responsibly. So we have to begin with the other world, not with this world. Begin with Krishna, not with the world. So don't tell God how big your problems are. Tell your problems how big God is. So we begin with the other world. Tell your problems how big God is. And then with that hugeness of God in our consciousness, look at the problems. And we'll find that slowly but surely, we will get the wisdom, the strength to set small things right. And then gradually, Krishna will either give us the strength to set big things right also, or Krishna will himself set them right. And we'll be moving to a better future for ourselves. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on how the Bhagavad Gita is an expression of Krishna's love for us. I talked about the contrast between 934 and 1865. Like Krishna is telling, you become devoted to me, you will come to me. But first he is insisting, you do this, then you will come to me. And then he is saying, you just do this, I guarantee you will come to me. So Krishna is desperate in a sense, that we connect with him. So when we are going through a life journey, we need to navigate and negotiate. Okay, where do I want to go and how do I get there? That is sadhana and sadhya. And for that, I talked about these four quadrants. So our goal is the other world, but the means is through this world. So the sadhya is the other world. The sadhan is we function in this world. So there can be four possibilities. People who don't take this world or the other world seriously, they are apathetic. They become depressed. They just can't do anything. People can't survive in this. Most of society today takes this world alone seriously. And that's how we have had phenomenal technological progress. But no matter how much progress we have, this world is never stimulating or satisfying enough. And that's why we have used the technology not just to improve this world, but also to create improved versions of fictional worlds into which we can escape. And the same people who reject a religious other world as mythology, they will take a fictional world with fictional characters extremely seriously. So the third quadrant is where people don't take this world seriously at all. They just take the other world seriously. That can lead to apathy towards whatever is happening, or that can lead to irresponsibility. As long as I get to the other world, how I act in this world doesn't matter. I can destroy, I can kill. That can happen to fanatical religion. That can happen to fanatical ideologies like communism, Marxism, anything. So then the bhakti attitude is a balanced way. Take this world seriously and the other world seriously. That is, we understand why God is the sustainer of both the other world and this world. And Krishna tells Arjuna that you have position, you have talents, you have abilities, use them responsibly. But it's not that work is worship. Krishna says, work as a form of worship. Work is worship means you don't have to bother about the other world at all, just work. That is, if work were worship, then the donkey would be the greatest worshipper. So work as worship means that understand that there is a Lord beyond this world, and it is He who is to be attained by our work in this world. And when we have this attitude, then what is the motivation for working? It is the motivation of service, of the connection with the other Lord, other world, and contribution in this world. So we have this attitude of service, then even if big obstacles come to us in this world, our whole plan seems to be shaken, our path seems to be dark. And that service attitude will become like our flashlight. Shows one step, Krishna, how can I serve you in this situation? And we have that attitude. If we look at Krishna first and then at the world, then the world's problems won't overwhelm us. Don't tell God how big your problems are. Tell your problems how big God is. And then God will give us the strength to face through our problems and ultimately achieve fulfillment in life. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Are there any questions or comments? Yes.
Okay. Which is the means and goals is still the same, but I know that when I reach there,
okay,
I'm not going to pass through that.
Yeah, that's a challenge. See, if you want to go to the other world, whatever the criteria for that, we are not meeting those. So how will we, even if we get there, we won't be allowed to enter. So what do we do? In fact, I have another class on this topic broadly, what I call it as digital and analog conceptions of bhakti. What I mean is, digital conception is one or zero. No, either you are a devotee or you are a non-devotee. Either I am meeting the standard or I am useless. But analog is a progression. In fact, if you see, the Bhagavad-Gita is largely an analog conception. In fact, it's not just bhakti. Krishna says, if you can't practice bhakti, then practice yoga. If you can't practice yoga, practice jnana. Can't practice jnana, practice karma yoga, karma. So Krishna, if you can't worship me, you can worship other devatas. Krishna gives so many alternatives. Even within bhakti, from 12.8 to 12.12, Krishna says that you spontaneously fix your mind on me. If you can't do that, then conscientiously strive to fix your mind on me. If you can't do that, then work for me. If you can't work for me, then at least work for a selfless cause. Work for something bigger than yourself. So Krishna is giving multiple levels for us to connect with. So we don't have to necessarily think that if we are not at a standard, at a particular standard, that we are not practicing bhakti. Bhakti is progressive. And if we just keep doing what we can, when we say Krishna says, yoga kshemam vahamyaham, that means I will protect what you have and I will provide what you lack. That applies not just for our material assets, it will also apply for our spiritual assets. So if we ananyas chintayanto mam ijana paripasate tesham ityabhyuktanam yogakshemam vahamyam. Krishna says 922 in the Gita, that if you strive to be devoted to me, then I will protect whatever spiritual advancement you have made, and I will provide whatever spiritual advancement you are lacking. So we have to really bother about coming up to a particular standard. We just dedicate ourselves to doing the best we can right now. We keep doing the best, either Krishna will make up for all that we are lacking and take us directly to him, or Krishna will take us to some place where we are closer to him. So yes, we all want to grow spiritually, but it's very important that wherever there are standards, the mind is such a thing that the mind can make even the most positive thing negative. That means that the purpose of standards is to inspire us, not to discourage us. That, you know, okay, this, if we hear about say how ecstatic the great saints Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Goswamis are absorbed in love for Krishna. Now when we see that, either we can think, I am nowhere near there. What is the use of my practicing bhakti? Or we can say that, okay, this is at such advanced stages, and these can be attained by practicing the process that I am practicing right now. Let me practice wholeheartedly. So depending on our consciousness, we need to adjust our vision. If we are feeling very proud, oh, I am so spiritually advanced, then look how far you have to go. Well, there's no reason to be proud actually. But if you are feeling disheartened, then we need to look behind to see how far we have come. And we all have come a significant way in our spiritual journey. If we consider 5, 10, 15 years ago before we were practicing bhakti, and now we have grown significantly, our values have changed. And we can actually, if we are honest, we'll say that whatever spiritual progress we have made, it is not because of us. It is in spite of us. We are so distracted, we are so impure, we are so conditioned. And in spite of ourselves, we still made so much progress. So just now, tomorrow I am leaving for India, so a devotee friend told me, says, have a safe trip. So I told him that as long as I am with me, no trip will be safe. Because we are often our own enemies, our worst enemies. So still we have covered a significant distance. And how has that happened? In spite of us, that means despite of our half-hearted, distracted efforts, Krishna has got us this far. So if Krishna has got us this far, Krishna will take us all the way also. Okay.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Any other questions? Yes, Mataji.
Should I make at this point still the worst, the situation when I'm in this
So if you are caught in a loop where we keep making things worse, then thinking of serving Krishna is almost impossible at that time. So what do? See, we all have certain impurities, anger, greed, envy, so many things like that. And we could say these impurities that are there, they are urges. And these urges have surges. So we may all have a certain level of annoyance, irritation, but sometimes it becomes fury. And when these surges happen, we might be powerless. It just overpowers us. So our devotion is defined not just by what happens during the surges, but also what happens between the surges. So, okay, that time I'm just helpless, I'm overpowered. But what am I doing in between? See, even if somebody is very short-tempered, it is not that 24 hours they are always burning with anger. Nobody can live like that, isn't it? So nobody can live like that. So, okay, during the normal time, what am I doing? If at that time I am striving to purify myself, to strengthen myself, to connect with Krishna, then what will happen is that eventually when the urges come, I'll be strong enough to deal with it. So don't define yourself or your spirituality by your ability to face the surges of the urges. Because that is we want to deal with it, but sometimes for some of us, some conditionings might be such that they are impossible to deal with, to overcome. So focus on in between. What are we doing? In fact, this is the mood of that verse, Api Chetsu Duracharo Bhajate Maam Ananya Bhak Sadhureva Samantavya Samyak Vyavasitohisa. Krishna says that a devotee may do terribly wrong things, but the devotee doesn't give up the determination to serve. Okay, I do this, there's this lapse, it can be a grievous lapse, but as soon as that's overcome, I'll come back and serve Krishna. So that's the first thing. Focus on what you can do in between the surges of the urges. Second thing is, try to find out, are there some triggers that provoke those surges? So now some people, there are some people in our lives who bring out the best within us. We just seeing them, associating with them, we feel inspired to become better. But just as some people bring the best within us, some people may bring the worst within us. Now we can't blame them, it is we who are doing that. But if that is happening, some people are triggers for us, then keep a distance from them. Not in a condemning, judgmental sense, but in the sense, this is not healthy for me. So it's, if somebody is trying to recover from alcoholism, and if their home is on top of a bar, it's never going to work, isn't it? That if their home is on top of a bar, they're going to be overcome. So that if something is a trigger, we need to create a distance. So that the surges, at least externals, we don't thoughtlessly expose ourselves to them. Then gradually, if we do these things, then gradually we will find out that even amid those surges, we will not get that much thrown away. That's why sometimes, in some cases, it's the spiritual advancement is, I was doing this and I gave it up. That's spiritual advancement. But in some cases, spiritual that could be digital. It's 1-0. It's complete freedom from that particular thing. But in some cases, spiritual advancement may be incremental, it may be analog. That means that yes, I get angry, but last time I got angry and I just yelled at this person so much. This time I got angry, I was angry, but I didn't yell at anyone. Or you could even make it, I yelled at someone, but I did not, use whatever, foul words or harsh words. There can be the surge, we can limit how much it goes. And gradually, that will start decreasing. So, don't focus on that part alone. Focus on the rest of your spiritual life and then they will be able to deal with that part gradually. Okay? Thank you. So, you had the last question? You had one question, Mataji? Yes, Mataji. Correct. Okay. Okay. So, even if we know that matter is temporary, still we hanker for it. Yeah, there are two ways of looking at this. One is that this world is a place of illusion. Illusion means it is like a trap. So sometimes some devotees say, Dukkhalayam, this world is a place of distress. Does that mean there is no happiness in this world? Actually, Prahlad Maharaj says, Madhulavai. There's a drop of nectar. And so the illusion is not about the presence of pleasure. The illusion is about the quantity of pleasure. We think there's a lot of pleasure over here. Most of the times, whenever we get some greatly dreamed about sense pleasure, afterwards, it is usually an anticlimax. Anticlimax. I dreamt about it and what I got was so little. So there is pleasure. So the illusion is not that there's no pleasure, it is very little pleasure. So the point I'm making is, this world is like a trap. So there is enough pleasure in this world to keep us attached to all the troubles that come with the pleasure. If there are only trouble, we would just give it up. If there are only pleasure, we wouldn't think about anything else. But there is enough pleasure in this world to make us believe that all the troubles are worthwhile. Actually, whether they are worthwhile is open to question. But because when we are pursuing this pleasure, we think this is so great, we think it's worth it. So the way is not just saying no to the pleasures of the world. In bhakti, we focus not so much on renunciation as on devotion. What does that mean? That means that Krishna says in the Bhagavad-Gita in 1041, Yadyad vibhuti matsattvam shrimadurjitam evava tatta devava gacchattvam mama tejo amsha sambhava. That everything attractive manifests a spark of my splendor. That means Krishna is not saying everything attractive in this world is false. If it is manifesting his splendor, then it's not false. Because his splendor is real. So the example to understand this could be, there's an ocean just filled with water. And there are many drops of water. So Krishna is like the ocean. The pleasures of this world are like drops. And Krishna is like the sun. The pleasures of this world are like sparks. Let's suppose we are here. And the ocean is here. Now there will be some drops of water which are over here. There are some drops of water which are over here. There are some drops of water which are over here. So now all the drops of water, they are all drops only. But there are some drops which are taking us toward the ocean, some drops that are taking us away from the ocean. So we don't deny the reality of the drops. But we focus on, where are these drops taking me? So it's not, say for example, Varanashram, the whole idea of social division, its principle is what? A Brahmana is one who likes to be intellectual. So the Shastra says, be intellectual, but be intellectual in a way that is spiritually harmonious. A Kshatriya is one who likes to lead, who likes to delegate, to control, to basically, you can say, boss around the world. In fact, one of the qualities of Kshatriya Krishna described in the Bhagavad-Gita is Ishwara Bhav. Danam Ishwara Bhavasya Kshatram Karma Sabhavajam. Now, Ishwara Bhav could be translated as the attitude, I am God. But Krishna is saying this is a recommended virtue of a Kshatriya. Not that I am the supreme God, it is not Parameshwar Bhav, it is Ishwara Bhav. That there are some people who just like to lead, to manage, to delegate, to control. Just do it in the service of the supreme leader. So, what this whole idea of Varanashram is, that there are certain things which are materially pleasurable for us. But do them in a way that will take us toward the source of supreme spiritual pleasure. So it's not that we reject all material pleasure. It is rather, we select that material pleasure that is in harmony with our spiritual purpose. So we accept that the drops are there and they are real. So, the whole idea is we don't focus so much on denying the pleasure of this world, denying that there is pleasure or denying ourselves that pleasure. Rather, we focus on remembering that, okay, this pleasure is a pointer to the ultimate pleasure. And let me pursue that path. So that's why in bhakti, it's not so much of what we give up as what we take up. Bhakti is not a process of giving up things in the world. It's more of taking up. Srila Prabhupada, if you consider an example, there were many other Prabhupada's godbrothers. Some of them were lifelong celibates. Some of them, they knew far more scripture than what he knew. But what Prabhupada had especially was the strongest desire to share Krishna with others. So Prabhupada took up that mission of sharing the message of spiritual love like no one else. So what defined Prabhupada was not just his giving up of material desires, it was his taking up of spiritual desires. So we don't try to focus on what all we have to say no to. Focus on what all can we say yes to. We can't crowd out worldly pleasures, worldly desires from our heart. Sorry, we can't drive out worldly desires, but we can crowd them out. So now we focus on what all can I do for Krishna. And what I am not able to give up, don't bother. Not that we don't, like I talked about, we have to deal with the surges of the urges, but don't obsess over that. Focus on what you are taking up for Krishna. The process of bhakti is not just that we are saved from, what we are saved from is not as important as what we are saved for. You know, we are saved, we are delivered, we are protected for a purpose. That purpose is to serve Krishna more and more. So take up the service of Krishna more and more, try to fill your life with Krishna, and then whatever is to be given up, we'll find out how to deal with it. So even if we indulge in some pleasure, no, we won't obsess over it. Okay, this is what I need to do, I do it, and I move on. Otherwise, we're obsessing over it, no, I won't do it, I won't do it, no, I want to do it, I'll do it. And then, oh, why did I do it? Just move on. So material indulgence is not as is not worth thinking about too much, either in terms of how I'll give it up or how I'll get it. Focus on the spiritual connection. Okay. So thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki Tai Gaur Premanande.